I'd like to thank you for allowing us into your homes for this sixth edition of Season 5 of Esoteric Science Roundtable. I'd like, thank Freeman for coming down to share some information that he's been researching about trauma-based mind control and its ritual symbology. This is going to be a very interesting show, so, you know, suspend disbelief on this one and check this one out. Freeman's been doing some research that he's been tying some interesting things together that are going to really push the envelope, so give this one a shot and see what you think. We're going to be discussing the butterfly effect this evening. And Freeman, if you want to go ahead and jump in, thanks again for coming down. Appreciate it.
And thank you, Kory. Yes, it's very important that we get this out. This is such a strange thing, and it's happening to all of us. And really what happened was a bunch of serendipitous events led me to the knowledge that I bring forth now. I was sitting back watching a movie called The Butterfly Effect. And this movie stars Ashton Kutcher. And it's a recipe for trauma-based mind control. The very movie produced by New Line Cinema's AOL Time Warner could have been written straight from Fritz Springmeier's Illuminati, How to Make Your Own Undetectable Mind Control Slave. Because the plot in the movie lines up with his genealogy, and this allows him to be better used by this higher order. Which we'll get into the Freemason connection into this. But it's his very genealogy. And then as he is used, what they do to create what we're going to talk about, the mind control slave, is child pornography, rape, abuse, some serious trauma, murder. And we're going to see how this is portrayed to us almost daily through our television screen.
And so just to touch briefly on this, for those that don't know, this whole concept of trauma-based mind control is not something new. It's been really scientifically perfected since about the 40s in the Nazi era, although it's even had its roots far before then as well, as far as psychologically, mentally, emotionally, and physically creating within a person's mind compartmentalization. And so we do through this disconnect mechanism, this means, or not us per se, but those that employ these methods, do this, and they use it again, the most extreme images and the most extreme torture and things of this nature repeatedly, and that's the key as well. This is repeated over and over again in a ritual fashion, and this allows this imprint to hit the subconscious at a level in which the compartmentalization can be tapped into with triggers. And certainly we may be familiar with the concept of the assassins for both Reagan and Lenin, that they were allegedly triggered by the book Catcher in the Rye by Salinger. And so it's curious about that concept as well, and we'll get into that a bit later as well. But the concept of trauma-based mind control is something that is the dark underbelly of this information that's not really discussed that often, but it is a very real issue that moves underneath the currents and causes a lot of things behind the movies and the shakings within politics, the entertainment industry, and a lot of places that you wouldn't normally perceive, that you wouldn't really care to perceive, but nonetheless this does take place, and we're going to get more into some of the details to try to help demonstrate that this evening.
Well, it's interesting that they titled the movie The Butterfly Effect, because what we're discussing here is a minimum input, maximum output, which is what the butterfly effect is. Mm-hmm. And so the butterfly wings flap and you get a tornado miles away. Mm-hmm. The MK Ultra trauma-based mind control program that is in action is known as the Monarch program, which of course is the butterfly. Mm-hmm. As we start to look, you will keep all of these coincidences in mind as we look at this picture, because what we're seeing today with Anna Nicole, Britney, Lindsay Lohan, and a number of others, you're going to find that there's a bunch of links and connections between all of these, and that they aren't just pop stars trying to cry out for attention, that these are people that have been put through abuse throughout their lives and raised in this environment that we can't even imagine. So when we start to look at this picture, we'll start to recognize that there are high-profile rituals going on, and they all seem to stem from Walt Disney. Curious this, because Walt Disney was an FBI agent and a high-degree Freemason. He was hired on by 33rd-degree Mason J. Edgar Hoover, who has his own room in the Temple of the 33rd, the Supreme Mother Council of the World. So Walt Disney is not what you think he is, and Walt Disney World is not what you think it is. What we see here is that this is actually all based up into psychological warfare done by the military intelligence. And it's always been military intelligence wrapped up with occultism. Mm-hmm. So as we see, Aleister Crowley was a minister or a military intelligence agent. John Dee was a military intelligence agent. This combination of occultism with the military intelligence. Look at the SS of the Nazis.
Mm-hmm, certainly.
Prime example.
Right.
And a lot of this comes
from... I would
say
NASA as well is a good example.
NASA as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I don't think we'll have time for Lisa Nowak, but maybe later.
Right.
So as we look and you find out that Walt Disney World is actually a military industrial corporation, every ride in the place is sponsored by a military complex. It's RCA Space Mountain, and Pepsi has the, well, it was the original funder towards It's a Little Small World. Mm-hmm. And it is said by Fritz Springmeier and others that have done deep research into these Illuminati satanic ritual abuse, mm-hmm. that Disney has used as a torture device to compartmentalize and bring about this multiple personality disorder, mm-hmm. dissociative identity disorder. And they will actually go through massive rituals inside the castle at Disney World after the park is closed, not to mention all the subterranean caverns all under there, which I have been in, mm-hmm. so I know they're there. And it's been said that Disney's most bizarre was that he would never come up from the surface, much like Cheney. He was always in the subterranean dwellings. Mm-hmm. And then he would come up and say, oh, he was talking with the mechanics. Walt Disney, if you look into his history, you'll find that we actually don't know who he is. His bloodline was obscured, as Hitler's were, and as many other that are within the Illuminati. Their bloodlines get hidden. But he was chosen to be the face man of this project. And if you realize that what Disney is actually a military-industrial project to brainwash you, that when you walk off Space Mountain, you get brainwashed into what they want your future to be, because this whole thing is a matter of them taking control of our imagination and telling us what our future will be. So when GE says to you, imagination at work, they're talking about your imagination working for them. When AT&T says your world delivered, we're going to learn who they're delivering it to. So to get, you know, into Mickey Mouse, to get into the idea of Walt Disney and actually being mind control slaves and perhaps putting a whole new spin onto Pinocchio, we start to look at the Mouseketeers. Mm-hmm. There was a very popular show way back in the day. I grew up on it. I actually have a stack of Mouseketeer certificates my mom received from Walt Disney himself. I grew up in Orlando, and there's a lot of weird stuff going on there, as in Austin. The princess programming is what Fritz Springmeier calls it when you go into these programmings. And the princess programming is actually based on to make you a sex slave. Mm-hmm. We're going to find that all of these Mouseketeers were used in high-level occult rituals. So for one example, before we get to Miss worshipful master there, there is the Justin Timberlake connection. Mouseketeer at the same time as Britney, same time as Christina Aguilera. Mm-hmm. These were all poor little children that were brainwashed together in a Disney program. We see them all of a sudden coming up in these high-profile rituals. So when Justin Timberlake got in a Super Bowl with Janet Jackson, and of course we know that the Jacksons were also ritually abused.
That's true, yes.
And of course they became pedophiles, or at least one of them. Allegedly. I won't get there. So what we see now with this Justin Timberlake and with
Janet
Jackson is the ritual of the god and goddess. We are looking at an ancient Babylonian ritual that goes to Ishtar and Marduk. It is a ritual that's been enacted from centuries back and continues on through today. We have many examples of it throughout time. We won't have time to get into all of that, but if once we get to Alan Moore, you'll get some more examples. So what has happened is Justin Timberlake stands out there and they have a wardrobe malfunction.
Right, exactly.
Which, of course, the Drudge Report got knowledge that it was supposed to happen. This was no accident.
Surprise, surprise.
Yes. And it's so obvious that it was, because what the symbols that we know already of the goddess and the god are, if you look at your Lady Liberty or Columbia or any of these goddesses, you'll see that there's always a breast bared. Mm-hmm. And on Janet Jackson's breast during this high-profile ritual at the Super Bowl, she has a sun, a golden sun nipple ring on her exposed breast. Mm-hmm. This is the unification of the god and goddess. This is the same symbol that we see in the hexagram, same symbol you see on target of the certain point within the circle, which is a solar symbol. All of these, Vonage has the same. This is all the hermaphroditic symbols, Venus, Mercury, mm-hmm. And Ishtar or Inanna with Marduk or Utu. So this is a long lineage of this very same story. So as we move on, we get to the music awards, and what we're going to witness here is Madonna, who is a professed Kabbalist.
Right.
She is the first openly expressing her Kabbalistic beliefs, really. I mean, we heard about Demi Moore and her Kabbalistic wedding probably prior to, but it seems to be a Hollywood fad at this time.
Oh, no question.
So Madonna has fully embraced her Kabbalism. She is also a Disney star. And she is also a 007 star, which gets into Crowley and John Dee and the idea of the moon child, which we'll get to in the end. So now, let's witness as Madonna, as the worshipful master in her top hat, mm-hmm. is coming down to raise Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera in a high-profile occultic ritual. Now, we all just thought that perhaps this was blatant lesbianism. But once you start to understand this brotherhood and their rituals and the fact that they want you all to be participant, then you realize what's actually going on here. And what is actually going on is Madonna passing on her high priestess status onto these two ex-Mouseketeers, and there was the third Mouseketeer there. So now, Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears have been raised to a higher place within this Kabbalistic order and within what is known as the Mothers of Darkness.
Well, you can see how it definitely has a very initiatory, ritualistic playing out, you know what I mean? It's very carefully choreographed, and it does have very much that, as if its initiation is being carried out, so that's quite odd, I have to agree. And again, these things, you know, there's a lot of money behind these things, so the symbolism and the reasons for doing these things often are multifaceted. And
yes.
So certainly we see these things being portrayed publicly, and that is something that I would like to touch upon briefly. When you see a ritual portrayed publicly, especially over television like this, or in a public place with lots of people in an audience, this is how you get more bang for your buck if you're using the occult, whether you're using it for bad or for good. When you have more people participating, you get more amplification. And so certainly by having these, again, I would agree with, I would call it, as you did, a high-profile ritual, publicly portrayed in front of the masses, this indoctrinates the public as well into the ritual. And so when this is done, again, publicly, you get more bang for your buck. And those that perform it gain more power through doing this publicly. And so that's all I'd like to really say along those lines.
Yes, and there, again, the butterfly effect.
Right, certainly. Maximum output. Absolutely.
What had happened after this point, Madonna then moves on to be known as Esther. She is no longer answering to the name Madonna. The name Esther is actually derived from Ishtar. It's the biblical version of Ishtar. And her husband is Mordecai, which is the biblical version of Marduk. So Madonna has now taken on the Kabbalistic name Esther, which is also a position within the Eastern Star. Mm-hmm. My mother was Esther in the Eastern Star. This is Ishtar. This is what we are seeing. So when Britney Spears walked into Esther's hair salon, my signals went off. I said, oh my God, but wait. This whole thing began as rock and roll did through Robert Johnson. It is an urban legend. I've definitely seen witnesses testify to the fact that Robert Johnson went down to the crossroads and he there met the devil and was given the ability to play the guitar. Mm-hmm. The witnesses say, oh, he just used to noise the place. He just noised it all up. But he came back and he could play like nobody else. Mm-hmm. And this was the very roots of rock and roll, was this crossroads meeting with the devil and Robert Johnson. Well, Britney Spears checked in for 24 hours into Eric Clapton's Crossroads Center for rehab, which is named after Robert Johnson's meeting with the devil. Mm-hmm. 24 hours later, she stepped out and walked into Esther's hair salon. Hmm. Now, one thing you're going to notice in this next clip is that Britney Spears has brunette hair. And it's very curious about this thing is, as we start to understand, there are very few people that have come forward with this type of trauma-based knowledge.
That is true, yes.
And there is Kathy O'Brien with Transformation of America, mm-hmm. Fritz Springmeier with the Illuminati formulate to create a total undetectable mind control slave, and then there's David Icke and his biggest secret, where he gets with Arizona Wilder.
Sure.
She breaks loose of the Mothers of Darkness. Now, this is where we get our concept of 1,000 points of light, and out in front of the Orlando City Hall, they erected a big penis in honor of this Orlando being the first point of light in the 1,000 point of light system enacted mm-hmm. by HW. Mm-hmm. Well, this 1,000 point of light comes from the stars up inside of the Belgian castle that is the Mothers of Darkness castle.
Wow.
That's where these Illuminists come from. I mean, this is... when you realize that the women are at the top of the ritual, they are the oracles. They are the ones, when Aleister Crowley channeled the Book of the Law, it was through a woman.
They're using or taking their energy when they use these rituals.
Right? And this is the same symbols again, the penetration.
Right.
So, witness that Britney Spears actually has brunette hair, and it was... Arizona Wilder, who clued us into what we're seeing here, because most people think she just went mad. But Arizona Wilder showed us that when she broke free of the Mothers of Darkness, the very first thing she did was dye her hair brown, mm-hmm. because they don't want their priestesses to have brown hair. They are infatuated and obsessed with the blonde-haired, blue-eyed people, the Aryan race. And you're going to find that this is a Nazi genetic experiment carried on, and that these bloodlines are highly critical. Mm-hmm. And that's a very big clue, the DNA connection.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So let's go ahead and watch this clip and watch how Britney actually shaves off her brunette hair.
Right.
Notice the Kabbalistic cross, or the hexagram, excuse me. It's the Star of David. This is Kabbalism. And in the back of her neck, she has one of the Kabbalistic names of God tattooed to the back of her head.
There should be, yeah. There should be sound.
Yes. Well, as you watch Britney leave, you'll see that she has quite a bit of a smirk on her face. And this is her escape. You can see the escape in her eyes. As she has actually managed to put one over on her handlers. And the news even actually commented saying that she was tired of her handlers. And this is a term used for someone who is in control of the mind control slave. If you see her smirk, you see that she is breaking free of something. Mm-hmm. And the story definitely got weirder last Saturday, mm-hmm. as Britney was checked into the Promises Clinic. And we're going to find that things that you think are perfectly normal or things
innocuous.
Like, yes, innocuous. Thank you. The KinderCare or the Boys Town, things that we think are innocuous are actually very nefarious. And we find that these particular places, to name your rehab center after a meeting with devil.
Well, this is portrayed in other movies as well, the shaving of the dark locks in some of the movies, V for Vendetta, and also Demi Moore shaves her head in G.I. Jane as well.
Yeah, if you understand that we are being indoctrinated into this trauma-based mind control, and so movies like G.I. Jane mm-hmm. are military mind control. That's exactly what mm-hmm. that's all about. She wants to join the Delta Force, and of course the Delta is the symbol of the goddess again, and we are go on and on. And that is open mind control. Everybody knows that they're going to go there and be mind controlled and turned into a trauma-based assassin. Well, most people don't recognize the nefarious nature of V for Vendetta. They think this is a wonderful film that tells you how to get clear. And I made a comment last night that if you think this is going to get you clear, then go join Scientology, which, of course, L. Ron Hubbard.
Clear to get clear, but there are different levels that you go through in the Scientology church.
Scientology, according to L. Ron Hubbard Jr., is a black ritual done over a long period of time. Instead of getting all your trauma at once, you get it in little increments.
Interesting.
Yeah. And, of course, that started by L. Ron Hubbard, who was Frauder H. in the OTO, and he combined with Jack Parsons and tried to raise the Moonchild.
Yes, interesting point there.
Now, it's curious that once she escaped on her path, and then she goes into the Promises rehab. Mm-hmm. She then scrawls on her forehead 666 and starts running around screaming, "I am the Antichrist." Mm-hmm. Poor Britney. It is said of the trauma-based mind controls that they tend to break their programming at 30. Britney turns 26 this year. So it's no surprise to me that they're starting to act out. Mm-hmm. And I say they because there's a few in this group. So she attempted suicide. She feels that she is the Antichrist. She's starting to recognize the programming that she did to little children herself without her knowing. You know, these songs were written for her. Her whole persona was crafted for her. She was then used to implant messages into our youth. And this is why we're seeing little girls running around singing, "If you want to get with this, you got to pay for it." You know,
right.
From Christina Aguilera.
What a role model.
Yes. And it's not these girls that are doing it. These are the poor mind control slaves that are being used by the masters. And sure. As we look deeper and deeper, we'll find the masters continually go back to Freemasonry over and over and always back into the military intelligence, which you pretty much have to be a Freemason to be in the military intelligence. I would say that you do have to be, but there may be one example where you're not. You know?
Okay.
Same with being an astronaut. You know, you cannot be an astronaut without being initiated. So when Britney walked out and went and got her tattooed and said, you know, "I'm tired of everybody touching me. I don't want them touching me." And she even said, "I don't want them plugging things into me anymore."
Right.
No one was too sure what she said about that. She is actually giving you the clues necessary to realize what is going on. And as the universe is also serendipitously giving us the clues to put the pieces together. Because as I mentioned, Lindsay Lohan, she is also another Disney star. And she also has now joined forces with Christina Aguilera, or with Britney Spears and Paris Hilton, and they are now known as the Anti-Panty Club.
Mm-hmm, right.
They are running around without their panties, showing off to the paparazzi. They're breaking free, folks. They're really trying to escape. Lindsay Lohan then checked into what is known as the Wonderland Clinic. Now, if we're looking at child pornography rings, we're talking about the things that are influenced with or are involved with trauma-based mind control, the CIA and MKUltra, are child pedophile rings, porn and snuff films, but also drug running. Mm. And These are all based out of our military intelligence, the CIA. When one of this groups was known as the Wonderland Club, and here's Lindsay checking into the Wonderland Clinic. This is either the universe trying to give us a big clue, or these guys are actually in charge.
Wasn't she trying to get some help as well, getting into some of these institutions or getting into some of these treatment centers from former presidential candidates?
Yes. Well, she thought Al Gore might be able to help her save the world. She knew her influence on children and even people over her age, even though she couldn't spell it. But yes, Al Gore quickly went and said, I only saw her one night. Okay, because this thing goes live. It goes all the way to the top. This is who your leaders are. If you're thinking that you're fighting toll roads, this is who your leaders are, and we need to move along so we can get to that part. So this Wonderland Club was a huge pedophile ring, internet, porn, snuff films, all of that, and it went through 22 states and 13 countries. It went all the way to the top, but just like all of these other Mickey Mouse courtroom events, nobody ever found out the truth. The fall guys took the fall.
Sure.
Just like this is the fall guy for another trauma-based event, what we know as...
Guy, whatever?
Yeah, well, Guy Fawkes, yes, the original fall guy. But I was trying to think of what 911 was beyond an inside job. Causing it to happen, you know what I'm saying? So as we're looking at this picture and we find out that we're looking at a bunch of Freemasons, we're looking at a bunch of trauma-based mind control, and we're trying to show you that the leaders in charge of our world are actually a bit stranger than you thought. They are not just after oil, gold, money. They are high-profile wizards that are causing sorcery around us in a ritual fashion. Should we... move on to Anna Nicole.
I believe it's about time for that.
Yes.
The disturbing video.
Let's try to see our list here.
And so certainly she's become a media darling since her death very recently, and there are a lot of shows that have sprung up, hour-long shows that have been featuring her and her life and, you know, recapping her and showing how tragic all this was. And so this certainly has been preoccupying a prominent place in the public's attention lately with Anna Nicole.
Yes.
And so you definitely have been able to tie her to some of the other buxom beauties in the past that have potentially been mind control. We can name Jane Mansfield, certainly the person she most emulated, Marilyn Monroe, ties into that little lump there. And so there's been a lot of speculation as to whether or not they were mind controlled or not.
And Zsa Zsa Gabor.
Another good point as well, certainly.
They are listed in Fritz Springmeier's book as presidential model mind control slaves. We certainly can believe it of Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah,
that one's pretty certainly obvious. Zsa Zsa Gabor is intriguing when we get to the end of this tale. And if you recognize that Vicki Lynn Marshall then became Anna Nicole Smith, Inanna are, you know, we're talking about the same goddess again. Okay, so what we're looking at, again, are these high-profile rituals that are enacted in front of us. They involve the god and the goddess. And what we see now is Anna being our very sacrificial priestess, our sacrificial goddess.
Okay.
You will find that she follows exactly along the recipe of a trauma-based mind control slave. She was sexually and physically abused by all family members, according to herself.
Mm-hmm.
They brought this into the courtroom. It was inadmissible evidence, but they showed it to us anyway, and I don't know why, because it didn't help decide where to put her body. She was her mother was a police officer, and you're going to find that these Satanists are constantly are police officers, lawyers, judges, people that you don't
child
expect.
Child Protective Services.
Child Protective Services.
Absolutely. Walt District
Disney,
Attorney.
People that you don't think. Hillary Clinton. No, all right, I'm pushing it. But I do think that. When Anna Nicole... was raised, she was then brought to this old man that was an oil tycoon and a Nazi, and he was to die the very next year. And they married her to this J. Marshall,
mm-hmm.
and he was then to give her all his money. Well, this money, I will tell you right now, wasn't set up for Anna Nicole, but was later set up for the child, as we'll get to Daniel Lynn. Mm-hmm. Anna Nicole was then, after she was given this marriage, then she was taken by Howard K. Stern. He became her handler. Mm-hmm. He was the lawyer that slept on her couch, the lawyer that never left. He was always by her side, and with every video clip you see of her, he's holding her arm. Mm-hmm. He's the man in the camera, running the camera in the clip we're going to watch. Mm-hmm. What we see is that in these rituals, they actually sacrifice their firstborn son. When Daniel Lynn was born, 3 days later, Daniel, the 20-year-old son, was flown to the Bahamas. And in the hospital room with Howard K. Stern and the baby, he dropped dead. Mm-hmm. Okay, this was the sacrifice of the firstborn. The curious note is that the doctor, the pathologist that said it was methadone, Lexapro, and Ambien, is none other than Cyril White, who was the very same pathologist who worked on JonBenet Ramsey's autopsy.
That is very odd.
Yes. And if you look into JonBenet Ramsey, you'll find that she was a poor child subjected to this and eventually killed. Okay, so I don't trust him. This is the same man who was actually accused of selling off 89 cadavers or under 89 accounts of selling cadavers out of his office. So this is who's telling you why Daniel died. So I'm telling you he was sacrificed. He was sacrificed as the firstborn on the third day of the birth of Daniel Lynn. This court case went on and on. It was quite the Mickey Mouse court. And there were many things that just were contrary to exactly what they should have been. And one of the other things was Mr. Ford Shelley, who had actually broken into the home. He's the one who actually bought the Bahamian home, brought Anna Nicole to it, and paid for it. But the house is not in his name. It's in his father-in-law's name. But yeah, he was called before the court. Mm-hmm. And he was called by the Texas side, who wanted to bury Anna Nicole next to Marilyn Monroe. But he said he didn't want to have her buried next to Marilyn. He thought that she should be buried in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. He totally flipped and was contrary to what he was supposed to be because right. He was brought up by Texas. And he brought in this tape, and they were very excited about this tape. And personally, I can find no reason for this tape to ever have been showed in a court case trying to decide where Anna Nicole's body would be laid to rest.
Good point.
But what it does show perfectly is a altar from dissociative identity disorder. When these children are abused at a very young age, this altar is their first altar, and it can be triggered, and they will appear to be a four-year-old child. Hmm. You're going to realize that what we're looking at with Anna Nicole is an altar. Now, I want to clearly state that the autopsy that was not done by Cyril White on Anna Nicole, which was Dr. Perper, who did the autopsy on Anna Nicole, found no signs of drug abuse mm-hmm. and no drugs in her system upon death. There was nothing in her stomach. There was no, he calls it a mystery and has no idea what killed her. But there was a few interesting clues where she had flu-like symptoms prior to her death. And she had a small bruise on her back that they kept trying to say that was from a fall in the shower. Anna Nicole's mother continually stated it was the drugs. It was the drugs. I tried to get her away from the wrong crowd. Mm-hmm. Didn't want her falling in with the wrong crowd. Mm-hmm. And then she went on to say, well, no, Anna Nicole wasn't on drugs when I sent her away. Always these contradictory statements. And then, of course, the autopsy showing no drugs in her system. All of the drugs found in the room were prescribed to Howard Stern. There were no drugs in the room.
That's Howard K. Stern. Just for
yes,
the record.
Howard K. Stern for the record. She didn't have drugs or drugs in her system. So this is very critical to understand what we're going to witness here. There's so much. Let's go on as we're getting that clip ready to understand one deeper aspect of this. Now, I had mentioned that this whole CIA operation was wrapped up in drug running as well. Mm-hmm. Fritz Mengmeier gives us a bunch of the codes and triggers that are used by these mind control people. Mm-hmm. And one of the codes that they use is Rhinestone. Mm-hmm. And that is a code for drug running. So when Daniel Smith called into the courtroom and said, well, I don't want my son's body exhumed, the judge ended the case right then and there and said, okay, the body's going to the Bahamas. Well, I wonder how many drugs they were running to the Bahamas in that coffin, because they made a huge point to note that it was covered in rhinestones.
I know, it's hard to say. I mean, the symbolism is intriguing. I don't know if I can really go with that connection full-fledged, but that certainly is one to add with all the other...
Interesting coincidence. So what I'm really wanting to hope to express to people, one is compassion, love of your fellow man, and that the fact that civilization itself is actually crafted by these evil beings, and that what we're doing as humans on planet Earth really isn't what we should be doing, because we don't know any better. We've grown up in captivity. We've always, or at least especially now, are fully under control of these people. When you see things like the TV show Heroes, mm-hmm. it's actually a form of trauma-based mind control as well. What you're getting is our blooding. And what you'll find is that many of what we call serial killers are actually covers for fall guys for these satanic groups. And, of course, they all had Mickey Mouse courtrooms. And you can find out more about that in Program to Kill. All of these books are at Brave New Books as well. We are getting our own blooding through TV shows like Heroes. And I had my roommate sit next to me watching as I was watching Heroes. And, of course, I see rape and I see death and murder, but we're all so desensitized that we hardly even feel it anymore. But my roommate was over there squirming in his seat like, I can't look at this. And I'm like, wow. I didn't realize how desensitized I had become. And this is the blooding. This is what they do with their serial assassins. They send them off into a war zone to become medics. You'll find that many of the assassins that we have had that were triggered mind control slaves were sent to be medics in war zones to get their blooding. So now we get our blooding through TV shows like Heroes. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the end of credits on Heroes and the symbol is a reptilian eye and the name of the company is Endemol, you start to see the picture. Well, I'm watching Bravo and I see a Dan and Nicole special and I want to see what they're leaving out of the picture, because they definitely left, that's what it's all for, is to leave out the critical information. Mm-hmm. It was produced by the very same company, Endemol. With their reptilian eye.
Pretty prolific there these days, aren't they?
It's astounding. I mean, I turned on the X-Files and it was the satanic ritual abuse episode. Mm-hmm. It's like God is trying to beat this into my brain and make sure that I see it all.
Well, just before the show, we were seeing the tail end of the previous show and it had Disney images before we started today's broadcast, and that was kind of
That was
intriguing.
Very serendipitous again.
Yeah, when we see a television show, we're all participating in the programming. This is programming, you know, even this show, you know, you could consider it at some level as well, but we're all subjecting ourselves to this programming, and certainly there are oftentimes the motives and objectives behind putting certain symbol sets and certain ideas and certain concepts within the plots of these particular shows. And so we get wrapped up in this, and this becomes something that we partake of every week, and then we ritually recur and repeat this process by further indoctrinating ourselves into the deeper aspects of the storyline.
If I could just tell our crew, if you would fast forward to the Ford Shelley clip and go all the way to the end of the Ford Shelley clip, right before 9:05. So we're going to time-based code 8.
Yeah, we'd hope to show the clip of
Anna Cole. It's very important. Very important that you see this. Because once again, what we're looking at here is a trauma-based mind control slave. We've proven that she was abused throughout her childhood and mm-hmm. that she is wrapped up in this very same thing, wanting to be Marilyn Monroe. Mm-hmm. We have data upon data of how all of this falls into play. And I think it should be quite obvious what we witness in Anna Nicole is an alter, a dissociative state, not a drug-induced state.
And also it's interesting that these pop icons are propped up, you know, to be part of this whole ritual enactment oftentimes, and that they're, and I think that's an interesting point to make as well. Oftentimes the ones that we see groomed, I think they are part of this bloodline that they're tied into this. But then we often hear about the CIA running around playgrounds and amusement parks, or you know, maybe, I don't know if the CIA per se specifically, but these dark-suited guys in these vans, and they're running around and they're grabbing kids and throwing them in vans. These kids aren't bloodline per se, but they're also being part of this trauma-based mind control program. So it happens at different levels. It has a lot of facets.
I believe they're working on Project Mayhem in America, and that there are many kids that are being set up to be agent provocateurs.
Sure, and I see that too. Whether they're going to be assassins, sex slaves, you know, any number of things.
If teen sport killing, you know, it's a big news right now. Okay, so let's start right at the beginning of this clip.
And this is really disturbing.
Yes, they've lost your mind.
You see there that she has no idea what he's talking about in a mushroom trip.
Right.
Not a clue. She's a four-year-old girl.
Yeah.
When she's asked, when he says this footage is going to be a lot of money, worth a lot of money, and she says, why? What footage? This girl has been in front of cameras all her life. Mm-hmm. She has been making movies. She knows what footage is, but not at 4 years old. So we're seeing that she is totally dissociative. This is not a drug-induced state.
And so if that's not the case, and there's really no good reason for her to be acting in that fashion without there being some really different explanation, I can't say what, but yeah, mind control certainly fits the bill.
And Howard K. Stern was the one making that film, and he was also the one who trapped Ford Shelley's daughter there, according to Ford Shelley. Now me, I see these guys in cahoots. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of effort being put forward to make sure that we don't see their links.
Mm-hmm,
they actually put forward a whole video about how his house was robbed, because this tape was stolen out of Anna Nicole's house after the death.
Right, right.
And then
really
Ford Shelley was brought into... Now, once again, Ford Shelley was brought up to have her brought to Texas, but said, put her in the Bahamas.
Right.
You know, it makes no sense unless you realize what's really going on here.
I agree that I think that the parties concerned are in cahoots, and they are trying to put up this dog and pony show that they're not involved, that they're not trying to have mutual gain at some level. So I do feel that, at least, if nothing else, for sure. It seems really, really weird.
So now we started this whole thing with the butterfly effect, and we're going to end it with a butterfly net. Because what we are looking at now in this high-profile ritual is the raising of the moon child. This Daniel Lynn Marshall Stern. Now, it is Howard Stern's name on the birth certificate, but he is not the father. They all know this, and it's pretty well known. And I'm going to say that we'll never know who the father is, and you'll find out why. So Howard K. Stern is in control of Daniel Lynn at this point, the child. No one knows who her true daddy is, because this poor sex slave was passed around to a few people.
Mm-hmm.
As long as they stay in the Bahamas, Howard Stern has control of her. And I'll tell you, Howard Stern was chomping out of the bit to get out of the courtroom and get back to the Bahamas. He actually flew all the way to the Bahamas to spend the night with the daughter and then come back to court the next day in Florida. Now, I don't see why he couldn't get a babysitter,
sure.
But if you are a handler, you need to imprint a baby as it's being raised. You must be the one to imprint that baby so that you are its mind control programmer. And when we start to get to the roots of who Daniel Lynn Smith is,
mm-hmm.
this little girl, we start to find out that it's not Howard K. Stern's baby. It's not Larry Burkhead's, although I think he believes it is.
Mm-hmm.
But the one claimant that fits the bill and is just too incredible to believe, but yet here he is, the very husband of Zsa Zsa Gabor, the initial mind-controlled presidential slave that we were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Prince Frederick von Anhalt has come forward stating that it wasn't those guys, but him, if you do the math, that was with her.
Yeah, so this is really intriguing. So it seems like with a name like that, he would have maybe some bloodline tie to some royal family, perhaps. He sounds like a blue blood by that title in and of itself. And the fact that he would be tied to this pretty well-known, acknowledged mind-control slave from the past, Zsa Zsa Gabor, and that he's also potentially tied at some level linked to this future mind-control slave that we're trying to determine or make that allegation or with the show here and try to substantiate that somewhat as well. Certainly that clip, makes you want to think about it, if nothing else, that Anna Nicole was under some kind of mind control. But yeah, it's very intriguing that this guy would be tied to both of them and coming out of the woodwork to make this strange claim. And I thought that to me, because you watch this stuff and you try to look for these hidden clues and causes when you watch the news already anyway, if you're used to this kind of information. But when that guy popped out of the woodwork and made that claim, I was really, really intrigued. I was like, why? What does this have to do with? There's got to be more to this,
Yes.
That's just, again, so I think that does lay more, fuel to the fire to kind of substantiate what you're alleging here. I think we've got the guy in our
There's Prince
sights.
Frederick and Zsa Zsa Gabor, prince and princess. Well, it turns out that this man is not who you think he is. He's not of the royal house of Anhalt. He is actually a genetic experiment through a Nazi program of Karl Clauberg to bring about Hitler's return.
Known as the Angel of Death and the father of artificial insemination, Nazi scientist Dr. Karl Clauberg conducted an experiment for the Soviets to artificially inseminate Gretel Braun, Eva Braun's sister, in the hope that this would produce the closest genetic match to a child that Hitler and Eva would have produced.
He may be Danny Lin's biological father.
Well, I can tell you they are not the fathers. When you go out very often till 4 o'clock in the morning and you need people, you do something, things you don't even know the next day what you did.
And if you realize that Hitler's true genetics is from the Rothschilds, then the connections fall together. You realize that Arizona Wilder states that there was a Rothschild in the tunnel when Princess Diana died, there to receive her soul. So if you recognize that Danny Lin is a Rothschild that has had two deaths in her presence, then you can start to understand who this child really is.
We're talking about presidential mind control slaves. We're talking about the raising of a moon child through a ritual, which is a way of bringing a particular spirit into a body. And there's ritual that's enacted. There's the death of the firstborn and the sacrifice of the priestess. And this is all used to bring about a particular incarnation. And of course, they need the bloodline, the DNA, to be the proper bloodline, the proper channel for this emanation. So when we started this with the butterfly effect, the book by Aleister Crowley called The Moon Child is also titled The Butterfly Net. And what we're looking at, presidential mind control slaves, how far does this go? Let's look at this next clip.
We're trying to find Bill if he's available from some footage that was shot.
This is from the Illuminati Part 2 by Enigma TV.
Yeah, so that's also something that's been alleged, is that politicians certainly find themselves under mind control.
Why would it be any different in politics than it would be in Hollywood?
Yeah, they're propped in front of the camera to help with the programming. They're part of the program, the face that we see out there, just like we see the newscaster or the talking heads. So that does tend to make sense. I agree with you quite a bit. So you spoke earlier about Parsons and
Elron
L. Ron
Hubbard.
Hubbard being involved with the previous attempt to create a moon child that may or may not have been successful, but you see this as a replication, a new take on an old spin
Yes.
trying to
Very
create.
curious things happened in the last attempt in the the bringing of the moon child with Jack Parsons. That's when we started getting, that's when Roswell occurred. That's when the flying saucers started coming and all the abductions with the Greys started being told about. And Aleister Crowley died at the same time.
So what do you think they might actually be able
And
to
the first
gain?
nuclear explosion was put
Right,
off in the
I
Trinity
think that's
experiment, yes.
difficult not to bring that into the context of that discussion as well with the UFOs. But What do you think they would hope to gain by bringing forth a moon child? What do you think would be the end result, and what do you think would, you know what I mean, the purpose, the reason for doing this?
That is the biggest question, isn't it? I can't answer that one.
Really? So that's still yet to be...
That's still yet to be determined. Right. You know, because I don't really think like they do. Uh-huh. And, you know, what I see now is that this goes higher than the third dimension, and that they go through all this effort for a reason.
Lampy, Missouri was a place where I heard George Bush and Bill Clinton talking. From the point of view I had, they certainly were friends, and they didn't recognize any party lines between them. That's something for the, you know, a smoke and mirrors illusion for the public. It's not something they adhere to, because they had exactly the same agenda, and that was for bringing in this new world order. I heard George Bush talking at that time. He was talking to Bill Clinton, and I've since photographically recorded it and wrote it verbatim in our book, that when the American people became disillusioned with Republicans leading them into the New World Order, that Bill Clinton, as a Democrat, was going to be put into the office of president. This was decided in 1984. Actually, I'd heard about it even prior to that. But that, as of 1984, they were already discussing it as an absolute fact.
So I wanted to finish the thought here. That's the one break we have to hit live. And around the world, but it's hard to believe we're being watched in 151 countries. Crazy. Ted Turner changed the world. He's a big fan of yours.
Is he?
He would serve you, Captain. You know what I mean? I don't know. Only slides. He's ready. What's he got left in life? After you're elected, think about it. No dope.
That's for sure.
Great guy to work with.
I love him.
Can we do any more? Can we do some more? Can we do some more? Can we do some more final questions? Have we done all kind of all today?
Transmissions from the Bush-Clinton presidential election campaign in the 1990s, we can see that Bill Clinton was nothing more than a puppet to the puppet masters which placed him in the White House. Bill Clinton's demeanor seems to be similar to a person who is under a hypnotic trance.
Or a trauma-based mind control slave. So... this really concludes our presentation. Your world is not what you thought it was. There is much more going on in our higher echelons of reality, of the politics, Hollywood. It has a much deeper meaning, and it subjugates your free will, and that's really what it's all about, is them taking over our imagination and crafting their world in front of us, and we merely being the poor servants that need to enact their bidding.
The way in which they unconsciously get us, you know, with this programming, we are at some level, we're definitely participants, and at some cases more willing than otherwise, but certainly unconsciously, when we subject ourselves to the programming on the box, it does have a way, even the flicker rate of the television, all of this has a way of conditioning our eyes, conditioning our mind, conditioning our emotions through the images that we see. And an image being worth a multiple amount of words, a thousand or otherwise, is certainly the case. And through imagery, this has been the main way in which the solar controllers have sought to keep their thumb on humanity. And we, I feel like, need to create images of inclusion, images of upliftment, images of true synthesis based on love, goodwill, right human relations. There's no reason why we can't, you know, don't we see more things on television about helping one another, about these good news stories? These things occur in the world, it's just they're not focused on. This is not what's installed into the programming mechanism for whatever reason. We don't get that. And we should, you know, seek to look for the good, but also when we watch the negative, if we're going to subject ourselves to the negativity, let's be aware of the programming and the level of the programming that we're being subjected to, and not just blindly look at the box, because it's going to be to our detriment if we just don't use our thinking mechanism. Again, the idea of creating these ideas, creating the images, you know, this shuts off half the brain. When we read a book, at least we're using some of our cognitive, creative imagination. In this case, we're having everything piped in and fed in directly to us, and it cuts off the creative imagination, and that's to our detriment. So we need to be more cognizant of creating our own images, our own reality, and our own understanding of the world around us. Freeman, I really appreciate you taking the time to come down here. And this is a very interesting topic. I'm going to be quite frank. I don't 100%, usually I'm about 92% in your Amen Choir with the topics that we discuss. This one, I'm not quite to that degree yet. There's some things I've yet to digest and really fully bring this in. But the synchronicities, the complexities of this, and all this that you've tied together is really intriguing. So I think it's food for thought at the very minimum. So you guys don't discount this out of hand without taking a little further look. Really appreciate it. I want to thank my producer Chris for commanding the helm of the Starship Esoterica. I want to thank Donna for helping navigate. We don't have a show next week, and I want to remind folks that we do have the Metaphysical Philosophical Meeting on the 21st of March at Spider House, 29th in Guadalupe. You guys stay tuned for Jeff Contreras coming up at 10 on Channel 16. I'm sure he's going to have a great show, and no audio difficulties this evening. So thanks, you guys. Thanks, Austin. Have a nice evening. Take care. See you soon.